This was the view from our seats at the London Palladium when we went to watch the musical Joseph the summer before last. Perhaps it was a musical, Joseph and the Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat, that came to mind when I asked you to think of Joseph. Maybe you have even starred in it, in some production of it somewhere. We are looking at the Bible's story and the 14 chapters of Genesis that unpack the life of Joseph. What does God have to teach us in these chapters of the Bible? This is a service that is for everyone. So if you have children in your house, go and grab them now. Bring them to watch this with you together, because this is a service we hope that will have something for everybody of all ages.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to our service today. We're standing in our kitchen. We're going to start by playing a game with you. I know you've all been used to games over the Christmas period, but maybe you're having to go back to some of them because of the lockdown and things to do. So one of the games we played was Articulate. So we're going to start that. We're going to take in turns to guess the words that we describe. Now, please play at home and see if you can get the words before I do, or Sue does. Right, so Sue's going to start.
And all these words will lead us into something connected with the story we're looking at today. Right, first thing I'm trying to describe to you, it helps you find out where you want to go.
A road sign.
No.
Okay, well.
You don't have to be on a road, it could be anywhere.
Okay, could be the sun, directions,
the sun.
North, south.
It's made of paper.
Ah, right, okay, that sounds more like a map,
yep,
maybe to me.
A map, well done. Right, next thing, it's in the sky.
Birds.
No. Higher, way away, further away.
Clouds.
No, further clouds, than that.
Further, right, okay, the moon.
It gives light.
The moon. And sun?
No, there's more of them, not just one.
Right, well, the sun's a star.
Stars, well done. Right, next one. It's round.
Ball, the football.
No, I don't mean that. It's bigger than that.
Bigger than that? Oh, well, maybe a round and bigger than that.
It kind of, we're in it, we're there.
Okay, we're in it, okay. Well, it sort of sounds like the world.
It is the world, yeah. Well done. Yeah. Right, okay. Now we're going to look at the PowerPoint.
Right, so we're going to just look at a PowerPoint with you. And okay, so we're describing, some of these words we're describing is about Joseph and his family history. So the first bit that we did was around the parts of the history, and Sue's going to just explain again why we had these words.
Right, so we're actually going back in time. Do you remember Abraham? We've studied him a little while ago in church. He was told to leave his country and go. He didn't know where to go. He didn't know where he was going. God obviously did. That's why we put the map in. The maps help us know where we're going to go. He was given some promises. He was promised that his descendants would be as many as the stars in the sky and the sand on the seashore. Now, this was a very strange promise, seeing he didn't have any children at the time. And he was also told that through him, all nations were going to be blessed, which is why we thought of the world. What an amazing promise to a man, a very old man with no children on his own. Right, let's have the next round of Articulate.
So next round, I'm going to describe three words again, so have a go. Right, so we're these things, we're not allowed to see them at the moment, these things.
Hmm. Well, friends?
Yeah, but they're a type
work
of people.
Colleagues.
In fact, we've got some in our family.
Grandchildren?
No, but children. The other end of the spectrum.
Aunts and uncles? Grandparents?
Grandparents.
Old people.
Old people.
Okay.
Okay. Now, the next word is some of you in church do this, but we also do it in the summer. We go
play games.
We go.
We meet with family. Well,
we go
on holiday.
Yeah.
Go
and
on
what
an
do
aeroplane.
We? What do we play? What do we? What do we?
A caravan.
Stay in?
A hotel.
We're still
oh,
in
no,
the
we're
old.
In a, we're in a tent.
Yes, a tent. Okay. And okay, this describes somebody at the other end of this scale. We talked about old people, but
we
talk about
grandchildren now?
Well,
toddlers,
yeah, but
children,
so they're young people,
school children,
but even younger than that.
Oh, toddlers, babies.
A baby. Okay, right.
All right, here we go. So the picture of the old people remind us that, as we've already said, Abraham and Sarah were very old when they were given the promise that they would have a baby. Amazing, wasn't it? And the tent, well, that's because Abraham and his wife, they were traveling. They'd left their own home. They'd traveled to another country. And while they were outside their tent, some people visited them one day and just confirmed the promise that indeed they would have a baby, even in their old age. And sure enough, the baby came along. It didn't happen straightforwardly. Abraham tried to take matters into his own hands initially, but they had a son of their own. Abraham and Sarah had a son named Isaac. Okay, so we've got to Isaac now. Now we're going on to our final round of articulate. Let's see how John does on these. Right, the first one is an animal.
An animal. Well, is it a domestic animal or a farm animal?
No, probably not. Farm.
Farm animal. Okay, farm animal. Well, I can think of pigs.
No, not a pig.
I can think of cows.
No, not cow.
I can think of chickens.
It eats grass.
Okay, well, that would be a
They're
cow.
Often in flocks. But, They're often in flocks.
Well, I would think of sheep then.
Oh, the male.
The male sheep. Okay, well, that to me is called a ram.
Excellent. Well done. Right. So again, we're back down to, we had old people, so it's not old people. It's
young people.
Young people. What did you talk about? It wasn't a toddler, it was a baby. So there wasn't just one baby, there were?
Oh, two babies.
Two babies. And what do you call them when they're both born on the same day? We've got some in church.
Yeah, I can think of a couple of twins.
Yeah, but they weren't like Jess Ella and Ella. Jess. No, they weren't
they were
like
boys
Jess and Ella. Twin boys. Well done. Right, the next thing is something you go up.
Well,
or climb up.
I go up a ladder to clean
windows. No, I don't mean a ladder.
I go up. Well, I don't go upstairs because we don't have any in the house.
Nah, well.
Okay, is it stairs?
Oh, it is stairs. Oh, yeah, okay. A staircase. Okay. Right, and the final one on this is a big number.
Well, a million.
No, not as many as a million. A big number for a family.
Okay.
Let's say.
Well, I think. Four is quite big.
Four is quite big, but it was actually more than four. We're thinking of somewhere between 10 and 20.
Okay. Well, are we thinking of 11?
No, more than that.
19?
No, less than that. A dozen?
A dozen. Okay. 12.
12. Well done. Okay. Because the man and the person who had 12 sons was called, he was in the Bible.
Well, this is what the story is today. So it was about Jacob and
Jacob.
His sons.
Well done. Okay. Right. Hope you all got those as well. So the ram that John worked out, that reminds us when Abraham was asked to sacrifice his son Isaac, he was prepared to do that in faith, and God at the last minute provided a sacrifice of a ram for him instead. So Isaac moved on, he married Rebekah. They had twin boys called Esau and Jacob. Jacob was the younger, but very strangely, it was him who God chose to bless through Isaac. And Jacob had an interesting life, lots of wanderings, lots of tussles. He didn't always get on with his brother. But one night he had a dream, and in that dream he saw a staircase to heaven, and people were going up and down it. And it was again another reminder. God came to him and reminded him of the promise to Abraham that there would be many descendants of his. And so in time it happened. Jacob didn't just have one wife though, he had two wives and two other women by whom he had children. So he had 12 sons and one daughter, and his son Joseph was born to him by his favourite wife, Rachel, in his old age. So she had Joseph and very sadly died when she was having Benjamin. So there we are, and that's how we get to the place of Joseph in the Bible. He's part of the lineage of Abraham, part of the genealogy, and a very important character as we learn more about God and his plans. So now we'll hand over to Andy for the next bit of the story.
So let's look at the story together. It's from Genesis chapter 37 in the Bibles, and it begins, this is the account of Jacob. That's funny. We often assume these last 14 books, chapters of Genesis are all about Joseph. But in fact, this is the story of Jacob. Remember, God has made some big promises to Jacob. And this is how these promises are being fulfilled. It is through the life of Joseph. And the story begins. Joseph, a young man, about 17 years old, he was looking after flocks with his brothers. And he bore his father a bad report about the brothers. Joseph's brothers, we've seen already in Genesis, were not nice men. We see it in this story. But whatever it is, he comes back and he tells his father what they have been up to. And Jacob, Joseph's father, loves Joseph more than any of his other sons because he'd been born to him in his old age. And so he makes Joseph this richly ornamented robe for him to wear. When his brothers see that Jacob loves Joseph more than them, they hate him and they couldn't say a kind word to him. Joseph had a dream and he told it to his brothers and they hated him all the more. He said to them, listen to this dream. We were binding sheaves of corn out in the field when suddenly my sheaf rose and stood upright while your sheaves gathered round mine and bowed down to it. Now, in the Bible, dreams are often what God uses to speak to people. And Joseph's brothers, they know what this dream is about. And they say to him, do you intend to reign over us? Will you actually be ruler over us? And they hate him all the more. Then Joseph had another dream and he told this to his brothers also. He said, listen, I had another dream and this time the sun and moon and 11 stars were bowing down to me. What do you think Joseph's dream might have meant? Who do you think the sun and the moon and the 11 stars were? Remember, Joseph has 11 brothers. Now, he told this dream to his father as well. And his father rebuked him. He said, what is this dream you had? Will your mother and I and all your brothers actually come and bow down to the ground before you? His brothers were so jealous of him. But his father kept the matter in mind. He pondered it a bit longer. And we will see later how these dreams are so important in setting up the story. It's as if God tells us the end of the story right at the beginning. Here's Jacob, Joseph's father. He's not happy about the dream, but he thinks about it. He ponders it. Now here are Joseph's brothers again. They've gone to graze their father's flock near Shechem. And Jacob said to Joseph, as you know, your brothers are grazing a flock near Shechem. Come, I'm going to send you to them. Very well, he replied. See, Joseph's obedience. He follows what his father said. I want you to go and see if all's well with your brothers and with the flock and bring word back to me. And then he sent them off from the valley of Hebron. We have a little map here. Hebron down in the bottom. Shechem, it's about 50 miles. And when Joseph arrived at Shechem, remember, he didn't know exactly where they were. He arrives there and he's looking for his brothers and he's wandering around the fields. But there is a man there and he asks this man. The man says, what are you looking for? He replied, I'm looking for my brothers. Can you tell me where they are? They've moved on from here, the man answered. I heard them say, let's go to Dothan. Isn't that amazing? Joseph was there in the middle of nowhere, didn't know where to look, looking for his brothers. And this man had seen them. And he tells Joseph exactly where they've gone. So Joseph went after his brothers. And he found them near Dothan. But they saw him in the distance. But before he reached to them, they plotted to kill him. Here comes the dreamer, they said to each other. Come now, let's kill him and throw him into one of these cisterns, these big these big pits that were full of water, and say that a ferocious animal killed him. Then we'll see what comes of his dreams, they said. When Reuben heard of this. He tried to rescue Joseph from them. Let's not take his life. Don't shed any blood. Throw him into the cistern here in the desert, but don't lay a hand on him. Reuben said this because he was going to rescue Joseph from them and take him back to his father. So when Joseph came to his brothers, they stripped him of his robe, the richly ornamented robe he was wearing. And they took him and threw him into the cistern. And the cistern was empty. There was no water in it. As they sat down to eat their meal, what? They have just tried to just chuck their brother in this cistern. And here they are by the fire, eating a nice meal. They could probably hear Joseph calling out in pain, afraid, terrified. And here his brothers are just eating their meal, as you do. What happens next? Well, they saw a caravan of Ishmaelites coming from Gilead. Their camels were loaded with spices, balms, and myrrh. Can you see the camels there in the picture? And they were on their way to take them back to Egypt. Judah said to his brothers, "What will we gain if we kill our brother and cover up his blood? Come, let's sell him to the Ishmaelites and not lay a hand on him. After all, he is our brother, our own flesh and blood." And his brothers agreed. So when the Midianite merchants came by, his brothers pulled Joseph up out of the cistern. They sold him for 20 shekels of silver to the Ishmaelites. They took him to Egypt. You can see the map here of the journey he would have had to go. Now, Reuben must not have been with them at the time, because when Reuben returned to the cistern and saw that Joseph was not there, he tore his clothes. He went back to his brothers and said, "The boy isn't there. Where can I turn now?" Then they got Joseph's robe. They slaughtered a goat. They dipped the robe in the blood. And they took the ornamented robe back to their father and said, "We found this. Examine it to see whether this is your son's robe." And Jacob recognized it at once. He said, "It is my son's robe. Some ferocious animal has devoured him. Joseph has surely been torn to pieces." Then Jacob tore his clothes. He put on sackcloth and mourned for his son many days. All his sons and daughters came to comfort him, but he refused to be comforted. "No," he said in mourning, "I will go down to the grave to my son." So his father wept for him. Meanwhile, the Midianites sold Joseph in Egypt to Potiphar, one of Pharaoh's officials, the captain of the guard.
We're going to sing a song together now, and then after that we're going to come back to this chapter of Genesis and think together, what does God have to say to us? What does God have to teach us through the story we've just heard read? But first we're going to sing of Jesus Strong and Kind. Isn't it great that whatever is going on in our life, Jesus wants us to come to him, to trust him, to follow him, because he is always strong and in control, and he's always kind and loving.
We can always run to Jesus. should come to him. No one else can be my shield. I should come to him. For the Lord is good and faithful. He will keep us day and night. We can always run to Jesus, Jesus strong and kind.
Said if I am lost, he will come to me, and he showed me on that cross, he will come to me. For the Lord is good and faithful, he will keep us day.
So I've got three questions for us that will help us think about the story. The first one is this: how are the kids? How well does your family get on together? Well, the family in the story is a bit of a mess. Have you ever had an argument with your brother? Ever fallen out over something? What do you do if your sister steals a toy that you're playing with? Do you A, scream at them, B, hit them, or C, go and tell on them? What do you do? Imagine having 11 brothers and one sister. That's what Joseph in the story has. I feel like I'm outnumbered sometimes. But what about his sister, Dinah, having 11 brothers? One of the things we see in the story is family conflict. So take Joseph's brothers. What words might you use to describe them here in this chapter? Joseph first brings his father a bad report of his brothers. They were up to no good. And we've seen already two of his brothers, Levi and Simeon, had already murdered a whole city. And one of his brothers, Reuben, did something pretty bad with his stepmom. They were not good people. So what words did you use to describe them? Jealousy, envy, hatred. They hated Joseph, didn't they? They were wicked. They wanted to kill him. Or betrayal, selling their own brother to be a slave. Deceitful, lying to their father, trying to cover up what they'd done. They really hated Joseph, and they were not good men. What about Joseph then? Sometimes people think he's a bit of a show-off, sort of boasting and proud. But I don't think the Bible tells us that at all about him. There's nothing to suggest he has any character flaw. Joseph, throughout the story, is honest. Yes, he tells his family his dreams, but wouldn't you want to tell someone close to you if you'd had such vivid, strange dreams? I think you would. When his father sends him off to Shechem to check on his brothers, he's obedient. He willingly goes despite the possible dangers. Do you see how Joseph and his brothers are contrasted? One is moral, good, honest. The others are evil, dishonest, corrupt. What about Jacob then, the dad? Do you know anything about Jacob? He was a twin. and his twin brother was favored by his father Isaac, and it was really difficult for him. And Jacob deceives his father and his brother Esau, and he tricks them into getting the family blessing. And it meant he was on the run for many years from his brother. Shouldn't Jacob have learned some lessons along the way about family relationships? Probably, yes, he should. Couldn't Jacob have been a bit more careful not to alienate Joseph and his brothers? Probably, yes. There's lots in the story about broken families. But even in this family that's a bit of a mess, God is at work. So that's the first thing. How are the kids? Not great, but it's not the main point of the story. There's more. Here's a bigger question to consider. Where is God? Here's a quick question for you. In the Bible story that we've heard read, how many times is God mentioned? Multiple choice. Is it A, 14 times? Is it B, 6 times? Or is it C, 0 times? What do you think? It's actually 0. You might think that's strange. A whole long chapter of the Bible doesn't even mention God. So where is God? It's as if almost we're sort of meant to ask this question. Where is God? Is he present? Is he there? And it may be that you have sometimes asked a similar question yourself. Why does God feel distant? Is he present with me today? We saw last week that if you are a Christian, then Jesus is not only near to you, but he actually lives in you and you live in him. He's always with us. We're always with Jesus. It couldn't be any better for us. So where is God here in Joseph's story? Imagine you are Joseph. You've travelled 50 miles, a long way, by foot to a place you don't know at all to look for your brothers who hate you. You're wandering around, helplessly lost. You don't know where to turn. And just at that moment, you see a man who happens to approach you and he asks you what you're doing and who you're looking for. My brothers, you say, have you seen them? And yes, this man who stops to talk has seen them. He's overheard their conversation and he knows exactly where they are and he directs you to them. He tells you where you need to go. Wow, is this just some amazing coincidence? No, this is God at work in the details of the story. This is sometimes called God's providence. And just listen to this little description of what that means. Providence is a word every Christian should know, for it refers to God's good government of our lives. We are not the victims of luck, fate, or karma. Rather, God has mapped out our path from before time began. He's active in all the circumstances, the surprises, and the choices of our lives. And he's all the time leading us towards his purpose. God's name is absent from the story at this point, yet he is everywhere present. Wow, that's a good description of what it means. For God to be in total control, even of all the details of the story. Where is God? He's also in the dreams. Dreams are often how God would choose to speak to people in the Bible. And the dreams give an important message from God. What did the corn represent? What did the sun and the moon and the stars represent? Can you remember? Well, Joseph's 11 brothers, they know. They know that it means his brothers and his mother and father all bowing down to Joseph and ruling over them. They don't like it. They don't like the message. So this is, if you like, God giving us the end of the story at the beginning. Sometimes the Bible keeps the end of a story and we're left waiting to see how things will happen. But in Joseph's story, God tells us at the start what is going to happen. God is present in the dreams. And also God is present in the unfolding of the bigger story. See, remember this chapter starts, this is the account of Jacob, because it's part of the story of God's people, Israel. God has promised many people a land and his blessing to live under. He's made this promise to Abraham and then to Isaac, his son, and it's now passed on to Jacob. This is God's bigger story. So, where is God? We thought about that. Here's the third question. What is God doing? And again, I've sort of answered this really, because look at the dreams. This is what God is doing as part of the bigger story. God has chosen Joseph out of all the brothers. God is free to choose whenever, whoever, whatever he likes. And he's chosen that Joseph will rule over his brothers and they will one day all come and bow the knee before him. God has told us at the beginning of the story. God has a plan. What do the brothers say when they see Joseph coming in the distance? This is what they say. Here comes the dreamer, they say to each other. Come now, let's kill him and throw him into one of these cisterns and say a ferocious animal's devoured him. Then we'll see what comes of his dreams. They think if they get rid of Joseph, then the dreams will not come true. They don't like the message from God that Joseph will rule over them one day. Their younger brother, what right does he have? So they think, take matters into our own hands and God's message won't come true. Little do they know, how wrong could they be? Of course, no one and nothing can stop God's plans from being carried out. Here's a verse I want to finish with from the New Testament, Romans chapter 8, verse 28. And it says this, and we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him, who've been called according to his purpose in all things. This is what we see throughout the story of Joseph. That in everything, through all the twists and turns and the ups and the downs, God is working for good in his people. Even the things that don't feel good to us at the time. Even in the illnesses, the viruses, even when bad things and painful things happen to us, God is promising that he's still at work and he has a purpose. The Apostle Paul writes, in everything that happens. What is God's purpose then? We see it in the next line. Those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the likeness or the image of his son. It is to make us more like Jesus, and God works through everything that happens to achieve this. This is what we see in Joseph's story. God has a plan, and he works through the small details, through the good moments and the hard moments of Joseph's life. Just as God works through every moment of your life, in everything that happens to you, however easy or hard it may be, God is at work in you and his purpose is to make you more Jesus-like. Wow. How are the kids? They're not great. Where is God? He's working all the time, even in this dysfunctional family. What is God doing? He's given us a clue through Joseph's dreams. And even the brothers, with all their hatred and murderous intent, cannot stop God. God is at work in your life too. He is with you even when he feels far away. He never gives up. He's bigger than us and he's in control. And he wants us to become more like his son, the Lord Jesus, who one day we will see face to face. And like the brothers one day bow before Joseph, so we one day will bow the knee before King Jesus. Will you willingly let Jesus be your king today? We're going to sing a song now that reminds us of some of the truth we've seen in this story. Nothing's too big for God's power. Nothing's too little for his care, because he's God of the big and he's God of the little and he's God of the stuff somewhere in the middle. King of moving mountains loves you more than you could ever know.
Hey! Ho! Here we go! Hey! Ho!
Enough is too
big, big, big for his power.
Enough is too
little, little for his care.
Enough is too
big, big, big for his power.
Enough is too
really, really for his care.
Here comes the elephant!
Father, thank you for the story of Joseph that is part of your bigger story. Thank you that you are at work through all the little details of his life. Thank you that you are always with us, even in the difficult times, and you promise never to leave us. Thank you that you are in control and work all things for our good.
To make us more like Jesus, help us to trust you more fully this week. Amen.